No, not one. No, not one. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one. No, not one. Oh, Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Oh, Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. Like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We certainly praise God for another day's journey. Now the Lord woke us up this morning and started us on our way. We thank God for all the tests and trials that come our way, but God is faithful. That he won't suffer us to be tempted above that which we are able. And with every temptation, he makes a way of escape. And we certainly praise and thank the Lord for his greatness and his mercy and his love that he has shown toward each and every one of us. And as we get ready to go before the Lord in prayer, we certainly want to remember men and women and children everywhere that the Lord will continue to save and add to the church daily such as should be saved. We also want to remember those that oppose us and those that come up against us. That the Lord will bless them and favor them and touch their hearts and their minds, give them heart and mind to do which is right in the sight of the Lord. And as we go before the Lord in prayer, if there's any particular prayer request, you can stand down and let it be known. Amen. Request a prayer for family relations. Amen.
Just continue to pray for the healing of my body with the condition going on. Pray for my family that God keeps us strong. We continue to serve them and come to church consistently and be a part of what we're doing.
Yes. Amen. All right. Well, we want to ask the church to stand. And let every heart pray, oh gracious Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we certainly thank you for the anointing. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the fellowship and being in the kingdom of heaven. We ask you, Lord, that you bless each and every request that's been made known. Bless us in our family relations. Bless us in our body. And Lord, we ask you to continue to heal, send forth deliverance in the name of Jesus. Let your grace and your strength, let it rest, rule, and abide with us. And Lord, bless our Bible study on tonight. That something be said and done to encourage us, to inspire our hearts. Father, we thank you and praise you. Protect us from danger, seen and unseen. Remember those that are opposing us and are coming up against us. We ask you, Lord, that you bless them in a mighty way. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, we want to go back over to the book of James. James chapter number 1. Amen. We certainly praise God. That you're pressing your way out, even on today. I knew it was a hot one. Amen. But God is great, and he's served up greatly to be praised. And we thank God that he has allowed us, as the scripture says, to come together one more time. He has allowed us. As we move toward the book of James, chapter number 1, I want to drop down to verse number 12, James chapter number 1, verse number 12. In James, his book, he's dealing with practical living, and in the midst of practical living, you're going to have tests and you're going to have trials. That's what life is about. When God had brought the children over out of Egypt into the wilderness, they were tempted. They were tempted to see whether or not that they would, that they loved the Lord, and to see whether or not they would keep God's commandment. The Bible says God proved them, and to see whether or not that they would walk in His ways. And God wants us to walk in His ways. And the enemy tempts us, and God tempts us. And when God is tempting us, He's literally testing us to see. He already knows where we are, what we're going to do, but it has to be made manifest. You can tell the teacher all day, yeah, I know the answer, but you got to prove it whether or not you know the answer. So you do that by your actions. That's what makes God just, amen, by your actions. He's just and fair, and He watches over your actions. And what you do is an indication of what's in you. So as we look at James chapter number 1 and verse number 12, it says, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love Him." And first part of this chapter, he said, "Count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations." So these two temptations, what he's talking about, they have a different. They're different in the sense that the first, when he says, "Count it all joy," he's literally talking about life circumstances, life situations. Life hits us sometimes. Car payment may be due. We might not have all the money. We may get a flat tire. You know what I'm saying? Life. Things happen. And when things happen, he wants you to rejoice and to be exceedingly glad. For great is your reward in heaven. People may talk about you, slander your name. That's life. Amen? So he says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. But in this connotation here, where he's saying, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, he's literally getting ready to move into being tempted with sin. And when he says blessed, he's talking about happy, being favorable, one that has God on their side. Anybody that has God on their side is truly blessed. Amen? You're blessed. So he says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, meaning that you go through it the right way. Man, God wants you to go through things the right way. A lot of us fail because we don't go through it the right way, God's prescribed way. You have to know what God requires and then do it how He requires it. One of the reasons why King Saul got into trouble was because, you know, he thought he was the king and he could do it his own way, and God accepted. That's not the way of God. God has never been like that. The Bible says He has shown thee, O man, what is required of thee. Amen. God puts it in our heart. Amen. What's required of us. And He has the expectation that we fulfill His requirement. Even when it comes down to forgiving, He says, forgive so that you can be forgiven. We oftentimes want to harbor and hold negative thoughts and feelings against people and want God to forgive us, but we have not fulfilled what He has said in order to receive His forgiveness. It's like a roadblock. Amen? It's like a block. And people really don't believe that. Because if they did, they would put it into practice and not harbor ill feelings against anyone. Because God doesn't want you to do that. God says, how do you endure? He says, talks to us about showing forth mercy. He says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall do what? Obtain mercy. So if you don't show mercy to people, and you looking for God's mercy, you won't have it because you're not doing it His way. Amen? So we've got to do things God's way. That's what it means by talking about enduring temptation, enduring tests and trials, enduring the temptation, which he's going to get into, is talking about sin. Amen? You can't give in to sinful, lustful, evil desires and expect God to bless you. You have to endure it, go through it, and resist it. The Bible says, resist the devil, how? Steadfast. All is steadfast, and he shall what? He shall flee. So every time an evil, wicked thought comes to your mind, you have to endure it and not perform it so that you can be blessed. Amen. That's what it means by blessed, happy. Amen. You got to keep your joy. And the Bible says, he that hath this hope in him, purified himself even as he is pure. So you go through the test without giving into it so that you can keep your joy, so that you can remain blessed. Amen? Because the Bible says the way of a transgressor is hard. And we have to believe that. Because God's word has said that. Hallelujah. And those are the things that we trip up on. When I say we, I'm talking about those that are looking to God to be their help, looking to God to be their strength, and wonder why, well, Lord, why am I weak? Why am I not strong in the Lord and in the power of His might? Why? You got to examine yourself to see whether or not you're walking in His way. Now, notice, he says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. That temptation is test. Amen? That's test. You're being tempted. And this particular temptation, he's going to get into it. He's talking about being tempted with evil. We always are tempted with evil. Why? Because we got an adversary, which is the devil. And his evil spirits are always trying to tempt us to do evil. Even when our mind is on the Lord, he's still trying to get us to do evil. Even when we are not even thinking about doing evil, amen, he's trying to get us to do evil. And if you don't watch and pray, Jesus said, lest you enter into temptation. You've got to watch and pray. Amen? Hallelujah. You really got to be spiritual minded all your waking hours. I know that we want to relax, but that's when the enemy gets you. When you're relaxing in your own mind and not on spiritual guard. I was watching a communion service that was going on, and part of it, and I saw some temptation come to this one sister, and there's an older sister, a mother of the church, and the Lord allowed me to see it, that when the temptation came, she literally was fighting in her mind to keep the victory. And the Lord showed me. He allowed me to see it. He allowed me to see it because he wanted me to see spiritual warfare. Amen? Hallelujah. God is good. Thank you, Lord. And I saw it, and I saw the spiritual warfare on how the sister was happy at first, rejoicing in the Lord, but then when the temptation came, you could see her whole countenance change. Her whole spiritual atmosphere changed. She focused on Jesus and resisted the enemy. Steadfast. Amen. That's the way we got to be. We've got to be watchful. Amen. Things can be pleasant at one moment. But then comes the enemy. Then comes the temptation. And sin is nothing to play around with. Amen. Hallelujah. Sin will kill you. Won't it kill you? The wages of sin is what? Death. Amen. But the gift of God is what? Eternal life. That's what God wants to give to you, the eternal life. So the Bible says, blessed, James chapter 1, verse number 12, blessed is the man that endured temptation, for when he is tried, because you're going to be tried, he said, he shall receive the crown of what? Life. Amen. And that crown of life represents eternal life. Amen. A manifestation of eternal life. And but you got to endure the temptation. You can't allow life circumstances, the habitual sins that want to overtake us to overtake you. You've got to resist the enemy. Steadfast. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And always be on guard. Put on the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand and withstand all the testing and trying of the enemy. Hallelujah. I know this ain't all popular talk here, but it's good talk. Amen. It's necessary. Thank you, Lord. Now notice what he says. He says, blessed is the man that endured temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive what? The crown of life, which the Lord has what? Promised to them that what?
Love
him. Now notice, he said to them that do what? And he notice, the scripture says, if you love me, you'll do what? Come on here, somebody. Love is the key. Love is the key. If you love him, you'll forsake your way. Amen. If you love him, you'll find out what his commandments are and you'll keep them. Meaning you'll perform them. If you love him, hallelujah, then you'll walk in the light as he is in the light. It's all about love, relationship. Lord has shown me that about some months ago. Holiness is about relationship. Thank you, Lord. And it's about relationship on every level. Hallelujah. And I got time to go into that. I taught it once before. But it's about relationship on every level. And in order to have a good relationship with other people, you've got to have a good relationship with God. Hallelujah. And not want to offend him. Hallelujah. And if you keep God's standard, everybody else's standard will fall in line. Because God's standard is the best standard. Hallelujah, my God. So notice what he said. He said, blessed is the man that endured temptation. Read, what's it say?
For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life.
He shall receive the crown of life.
Which the Lord hath promised to them that love him.
Notice, he said, which the Lord had promised to them that do what?
Love him.
Love him. Now, that word endure temptation, it has the meaning of to remain what? Faithful to God. While you're being tempted, you remain faithful to God. You remain faithful to his commandments. And you allow it, the temptation to pass. If we were teaching about an individual having a panic attack or an anxiety attack. And if I had a class here, and I would say that if you're having a panic attack, the worst thing that you can do is freeze up and try to make that thing go away. The best thing that you can do for a panic attack is to relax and let it pass. The more you try to fight it off in the sense of the panic attack, it's going to intensify. It's going to intensify. What he's talking about here as opposed to enduring temptation, you remain faithful until that desire passes. This too shall pass. And how do you remain? That's about enduring. How do you remain? You keep your mind stayed on him. You plead the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
You quote some scriptures. You put on the whole armor of God until that desire passes. Amen. Y'all with me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. You don't just go give in to evil. That's the worst thing you can do. Just give in to evil. Evil comes to your mind and you give in to it. People do this. Amen. Evil comes to their mind with the Holy Ghost. They don't resist the devil. They give in to it. Why? Because it's a lack of self-control. God wants you to have self-control. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, notice. He said, blessed is the man that endured temptation. Now, the ability to endure means to remain faithful while you're going through it, while you're being tempted, because everybody's going to be tempted. Everybody's going to be tried. Amen? But you got to remain faithful while you're going through it. And have some fortitude. Meaning like, when I say have some fortitude, get upset that temptation would even come. And then build yourself up on your most holy faith. If you're being tempted with evil, lustful desires, you should not just take that lying down. That's an indication that if you don't overcome it will overcome you. Amen. One of the most profoundest Bible classes that I was in with Bishop Ratcliffe when I first got saved, he said, you newly saved saints, he said, you're in a dangerous place. You could go either way. He said, you need to do something. At least the enemy come and overtake you. Amen. And what he was saying was, is that if you don't build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, studying and reading the Word of God, and putting God's Word into practice, the enemy will come and take you captive at his own will. And after he taught that Bible study, it made me to realize that I'm in a valley. I could go either way. So I had to choose. I had to fortify myself. When you fortify yourself, you can endure. it's like how the enemy's on the outside and you're on the inside and he's trying to starve you out. If you have all the supplies you need on the inside, it doesn't matter how long he's trying to attack you. You're fortified. You're ready. You can endure. You can go through. Hallelujah. That's what we got to do. We got to build ourselves up, fortify ourselves so that we can endure. No matter how long the attack, no matter how severe the attack, we can endure. We're ready. Amen. Hallelujah. Be ready. Thank you, Jesus. And don't ignore the warning signs. If you're always tempted by a certain situation or a certain condition that wants to lead you into sin, don't ignore it. resist. Hallelujah, the enemy. That's how you are blessed. Thank you, Jesus. Now notice, the only way for you to overcome the attack of the enemy is to apply the word of God. You can't apply your own strategy to try to overcome Satan. Do what you want to do and try to overcome the enemy. Hallelujah. You've got to know God's word and apply God's word to that situation so that you can overcome it. Amen?
Amen.
Now notice, let's just go over here to the book of, hold that, we're going to come back to it. Just go over here to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 4. You got it? 2 Corinthians chapter number 4 and verse number 7. It says, but we have this treasure in what? Earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of who? God, and not of ourselves. Notice what he said. We are troubled on every side. But if you're trusting in God, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but what? Not in despair. You don't lose hope. Persecuted, but not what? We're cast down, but what? Always bearing in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that what? The life also of Jesus might be manifest where? In our bodies. Notice, we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be what?
Manifest in our mortal
flesh. Might be what?
Manifest in our mortal flesh.
Might be made manifest in us. So when I'm enduring temptation, Jesus endured temptation, and life was made manifest in him. So when we endure temptation, life is being made manifest in us. How do you know an individual has eternal life abiding within them? By the fruits that they bear. By the life that they live. Hallelujah. My God. That's how you know that eternal life is abiding. Those that are in darkness, they live a sinful lifestyle. They're not carrying around a treasure in earthen vessels that have given them power to overcome. Hallelujah. God has given you something that has power with it. Hallelujah. That you can overcome. Amen. Y'all believe that tonight?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's go back over. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go back, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter number 10 and verse number 4. You got something to resist the devil with. Notice, let's read that together. What does it say?
For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal.
Yeah. So the weapons that we use are not what?
Carnal.
So therefore, I can't use different weapons to overcome the devil. I got to use what God supplies. Amen? What are some of the weapons that God supplies?
The sword.
Huh?
The sword.
The sword, the shield of faith. Well, tell me what that is. Tell me what the sword is.
Sword of God.
Huh?
Sword of the Spirit. Spirit of God.
But what is the sword?
Word of God.
the word of God, right? God gives you the word, doesn't he? What is the shield?
Faith.
God gives you faith. And that faith that he gives you is for what purpose? What is faith given to you for? That's not what it said. What does it say? To quench the fiery darts of the wicked. Meaning that to quench his accusations that he throws at you that are intensified. Because they fire. Follow me? What are some of the other weapons? Now let's go back to what you said about the word. How do I use the word as a weapon? Simple answer, huh? Inside voice, outside voice.
Use the word to fight the thoughts.
What she said?
Use the word to fight the thoughts.
All right. So what she's saying is putting the word into action. That's what she's saying. Put the word into action. Right? What are some of the other weapons?
The helmet of salvation.
The helmet of salvation. What is that?
That a lifestyle of holiness.
The helmet of salvation. The lifestyle of holiness. Is that what you said? It goes to walking in deliverance. Salvation equals deliverance. And you got to look at the helmet as what goes on your mind. Covers your thoughts, your mind. So you're keeping your mind and your thoughts delivered at all times. He said, I'll keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on me. Well, these are weapons. What other weapons we got? Breastplate of righteousness. What is that?
Right behavior, right living.
Thank you. That's it. Right behavior. Doing things right. Who defines what's right? God. Doing it God's way. Anytime you see the word righteousness, you're dealing with right behavior. Doing things God's way. Amen? What are some of the other weapons?
The gospel of peace.
So you're using the gospel as a what? As a what? A foundation for which you ought to stand. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. Pardon me? Thank you, Lord. That's true. Prayer is a weapon. Right? It's a weapon. A weapon of warfare. Say again? Ah, Jesus. I can't hear you, brother. Yeah! That's a weapon. Because you always got to look back on your testimony to encourage you moving forward. That's why God always, when he delivered his people, remember, especially when he told Joshua, I want you to go over to that land. And then when he crossed the Jordan, he told the priest to go back and grab 12 stones. Set it up as a memorial. When David, he cut off the head of the Goliath. He took it back to his tent as a memorial. Those are weapons of warfare. Thank you, Jesus. We can spend a lot of time on these weapons. And these weapons of warfare, the Bible said, are not what? They're not carnal, but what?
Mighty.
There's some power to it. Mighty through God. And you can do what? Pull
down strongholds, fortify thoughts that are in your mind, that war in your mind and your spirit against God, against His will, against His way. Doubts, unfaithfulness, follow me, fear. Those are all strongholds that the enemy uses to keep us captive. Amen? And you know, God doesn't want you to be captive. He doesn't want you to be bound. Mother Davis?
We might not realize it, but obedience.
Obedience! That's what I was really after.
Obedience is a weapon, so it's prayer.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Obedience. Woo, Jesus. A weapon of warfare. It's better to obey than sacrifice. It's better for me to do what God said do other than doing something that I feel is right. It's not about my feeling. It's about what God has said. Amen? And I always think about that when I think about that brother that when the Ark of the Covenant was falling off the ox, he was trying to be a good Samaritan by going under it to hold it up. Huh? And God struck, killed him. Huh? And, because they weren't being obedient. Good intentions is not obedience. You have all the good intentions you want. But if you're not doing it God's way, you won't be successful. Amen? Notice what it said. Casting down, verse number 5, casting down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. That imagination or high thing is your thoughts, ideas, and opinions. The thoughts of Satan's ideas and opinions that enter into your heart. Thoughts, ideas, of opinions of evil people that don't walk in the way of God. Those, you got to guard yourself. Amen? You got to watch. Watch who you give your ear to. Watch who you give your heart to. Amen? Notice then. Then he says, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of who? Christ. There's that word obedience, a weapon. You got to bring every thought that comes to your mind that is not according to the mind of Christ. You got to bring that into obedience to the word of God. Amen? Hallelujah. Now notice. Verse 6. And have it in readiness to what? To avenge all disobedience. When what? When your obedience is fulfilled. Amen? You want God to do something for you. Move your mountains. God gives you the strategy. Warfare. Strategies. And until you do what God says do, you're going to always have that struggle. Because your obedience is not fulfilled. But when you apply what God's word has said, God will send His grace. God will send His mercy. God will avenge you speedily. And that means that right early. Why? Because you have obeyed my word. You put your trust in me. Amen? Now, I'm going to get a little deep here. I can say I trust God all day long, but until I step out on it, it's not trust.
Come on.
It's a belief.
Come on.
Amen. But when I step out on it and I let go, now, Lord, I trust you. I trust you to keep me. I trust you to hold me up. I trust you not to allow me to be ashamed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. That's trust. Let go and let God. That's trust.
Holy God.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's move on.
Reason I said obedience because my mind went back to Isaac.
Yeah.
When God told him to offer up his son.
Yeah.
And when Isaac
Abraham had to offer up his son.
That was Isaac he offered up.
Oh, yeah. Yep, gotcha.
I had it wrong. Yeah.
Go ahead.
But anyway, when Abraham obeyed God, when he drew his hand back, that's when God says, I know. Now I know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because he put it into action.
He put it into action.
He's got to kill his son.
He's going to kill him.
And God said, no, that's all right. I know you believe.
Right.
So obedience is very important.
Yeah.
And that's when God can have that testimony for us.
Yeah.
If you obey him, then he can say, now I know you believe.
Now I know. Amen. And then scripture says God had received him in a like figure. Thank you, Lord. In other words, God had counted that boy as good as dead because he was going to do it. Amen. Thank you, Lord. He put his trust in God. Believing now. This is Abraham's faith. Believing that God was able to raise him from the dead.
Amen.
He believed God.
He
trusted God.
Yes, he did.
And it had to be put into action.
Yeah.
He endured. He remained faithful.
Yes, he did.
While he was being tempted.
Yes.
Amen. You've got to remain faithful to God while you're being tempted.
Yes.
Just believe God. You ain't gotta understand God or understand how he's going to do it. Just believe that he will. And be willing to go all the way.
Yes, Lord.
Be faithful. Be faithful to win. Unto death. Yes. Amen. Be faithful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank God. You don't hear people talk like that nowadays. Be faithful unto death. Don't just be faithful until you get tired. Don't just be faithful until bad situations happen. Bad situations will happen all the time. Be faithful. Trust your God. Amen? All right. Now notice. Let's go back over to James. We almost done. I ain't going to keep y'all all night. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, glory. James, chapter number 1 and verse number 12. Notice what he said. He said, blessed is the man that endured temptation. Read. Of God, but then when they're tempted of evil, that they are tempted with by who? God. Amen? Because God, he won't tempt you with evil, will he? It's impossible for God to tempt you with evil because he's God. Amen? Thank you, Lord. So when you're being tempted with evil, who's tempting you? The devil. Amen? And why do we give in to that? We know it ain't God. Charmaine said, she said something I want to say for 20 years. It's not. But she said, people, and that word stupid means ignorant. And the Bible tells us that we ought not to be ignorant of what? Amen. So don't be ignorant, brethren. Let's go over real quick to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 6. I'm sorry. Go over to Deuteronomy chapter number 8. Do you have it? Notice what this is God. Deuteronomy means to repeat. God is repeating his laws. And Deuteronomy 8, he says, all the commandments which I command thee this day shall ye do what?
Observe
to do. For what reason?
That
ye may what?
Live.
And do what? Increase. And go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers. So when God gives us a commandment, the commandment is given to us for life. Amen? He said, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive a crown of what?
Life.
And that's given to them that do what? Love him. Amen? Now notice. Verse number 2, read. Minister Grady said the testimonies of God is a weapon. You gotta remember how God has led you and guided you, and how God is faithful at all times. Sometimes when we get into trouble, we forget. We forget who we're dealing with. That's why you got to get around somebody that's spiritual to always remind you of who you're dealing with.
Yeah.
Sometimes we can't see the forest because of the tree, because of what I'm in. Amen? And we take stuff personal. And when you start to take stuff personal, the enemy got you.
Yeah.
Oh, let me say that again. When you start to take tests and trials personal, afflictions personal, then the enemy's got you. Because now you're on a whole other level. You angry, you upset, you mad, you confused. Amen? Why? Because you took it personal. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Notice, he said, I've led you these 40 years in the wilderness. I tested you these 40 years in the wilderness to do what? To humble you. When tests and trials come, they're coming to humble you. Amen?
Yeah.
Humble yourself beneath the mighty hand of God so God can exalt you. Amen?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Read, to humble thee,
and prove
to prove thee, meaning to see what you will do. Tests and trials come, temptation comes, to see what you're going to do. God allows the enemy, because he can't tempt you with evil, to come to see what you're going to do. To see whether or not you're going to remain faithful. See whether or not you're going to endure it. So you can see where you are in God. Your level of maturity, your level of growth. See where your desires lie. Huh? See where your affections are. See how long, hallelujah, you're going to hold out. Hallelujah. All right, read. To prove thee.
To know what was in thy heart.
Now, God allows tempts and trials to come so that you'll know what's in your heart. How important is the heart? What does the scripture say about the heart? Huh? Ooh, I can't hear that fan. I need a mic to be passed. The Bible says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, right? It talks about for you to know your heart. Our heart is what? Wicked and desperately, deceitful. Yeah, it's deceitful and desperately what?
Wicked.
And he says, who can know it? God knows it. Your heart will deceive you. Amen?
Amen.
So God God allows tests and trials for to come upon you to see where you at, see where your heart is. Amen? Hallelujah. You've got to endure certain tests and trials. When I say certain, I mean all. So that you can be able to pass the test. Notice. He said, he does it to humble thee, to prove thee, to know what is in thine heart. Read. Whether or not you're going to keep his commandments. You can't keep what you don't know. Amen? So you got to know what God commands in life situations and obey it. Do we believe that? Do we take time to study God's word, especially when we get into situations? Lord, what does your word say I should do? It's a handbook. It's a manual. Huh? Basic instructions before leaving earth.
Come on, yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It's a manual. And you've got to know what God commands and take a command not as a suggestion. Sometimes we do that. We take a command as a suggestion. A command is not a suggestion. You get upset with your children if you tell them to do something and they don't do it. How much more God? And you tell them so that you may feel good. God tells you so that you can live. Huh? All right. Notice. Let's go back over. It's John. John chapter 3. James. James chapter 3. Notice what he says. Verse 14. But every man is tempted when he is what?
Drawn away from his own lust and enticed.
Now, temptation comes when a person is drawn away of their what? And enticed of their what? Own love. Right? So when the enemy presents it, if you're not drawn away or enticed, are you tempted? Let me say it again. When the enemy presents it, and you're not drawn away or enticed, are you tempted? No. Why not? Why? Because it's that thing is not in you. Right? So if you're tempted, there's something in you that you've got to get out of you, that you've got to overcome. Why am I making that point? Got to be in you. And if it's revealing that it's in you, it's serious. It can take you out. Am I right? So don't ignore it. Don't ignore it. If I'm being tempted with lust and evil desire, that's contrary. All lust is contrary to the will of God. All lust. Some people, I've heard some people teach that you gotta have lust in order to love your wife, to make love to your wife. That's false doctrine. That's false. God wants you to get rid of lust. Lust is evil. Lust is evil desires. Amen? Hallelujah. If you're being tempted with that which is evil, there's something that's in you that's enticing you, that's luring you. And that's how the enemy gets you. He lures you. He's like Amazon that always sends you pop-ups. They know what you're searching. And they'll get those algorithms to fall into play. So when you wake up in the morning, you look at your email, you got pop-ups. To entice you. Today you may be strong, say, delete. But they keep doing it because they know it's in you. And one day they're going to catch you when you're discouraged, when you're weak, when you feel like you got extra. That's the same way with the enemy. He knows because you have made him aware. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost is good. You have made him aware that this is what you like. So he's going to keep coming to allure you. And if he's going to catch a fish, you got to have the right bait. So he's going to send you the right bait to catch you. So you've got to, if it's not in you, it will have no effect over you. Am I right? So you got to get it out of you. How do you get it out of you? By resisting it. Steadfast. If you don't feed it, it will die. I'm going to say something pretty controversial. You can fast 40 days. And after your fast, you go back to that thing that you're trying to fast from willingly, you won't have any victory. But if you abstain from it, and abstain from it, it'll die. Just make up in your mind, I'm not going back. Make up in your mind, it's a done deal. It's over. Follow? Now, I'm not coming up against fasting because fasting is necessary. But I'm trying to show you the power in having a made up mind. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Mother Davis?
That's the problem, Bishop, because when you are tempted of something, or whatever it might be, or whoever it might be, when you're tempted, you keep playing around with that.
That's it.
You keep playing around with it. You know, a lot of times we like to flirt as women.
Right.
We flirt around, you know, because we know this guy likes us, but we know he ain't right for us.
Right.
But we keep flirting around. We're feeding that thing.
Feeding it.
I can go on a fast, like you said, 40 days.
Right.
My heart is not right.
Right.
Even when I went on that fast, my heart is not right because I keep playing around with the thing.
Right.
I have no intention of giving it up. But I think I'm going to change God's mind.
Come
that's
on.
Gonna happen.
Come on.
So you got to kill that thing by not giving into it. And the more you say no, 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 more you're getting victory. More.
Yes.
Victory. Every time you say no, you're getting stronger and stronger. Even though it's hurting your flesh.
Yeah.
It hurt. But you keep saying no, 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 then you're getting stronger. Eventually you will get the victory.
Teach mother.
God will help you. He will help you to overcome. If you keep giving into that thing, it's gonna overcome you, and next thing you know, you're in trouble.
Absolutely.
Your very soul is in trouble.
Very soul in trouble.
Yes.
So did y'all hear what she said? Beautiful. You gotta abstain from it. Say no. Huh? Until no becomes your way of living. Notice what he said. He said, verse 15. He says, then when lust is conceived, it brings forth what?
Sin.
So once lust has been conceived in one's heart, one's desire, it has to bring forth an action, and that action is sin. The child of lust is sin. Father, conceive. Parent is lust. What lust births is sin. Don't y'all see that? The parent is lust. What lust produces is sin. Follow me? And then the next generation of sin is death. Sin produces death. The parent of sin, or the parent of death, is sin. Follow? It's generational. It's the next step, the next line. So you can't play around with it. That's the only thing that you can produce. If you're playing around with it, not thinking that it's going to produce what the Bible said, you're deceived. Don't deceive yourself. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he what? Also reap. Notice this. He says, then when lust hath conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it brings forth what?
Death.
That death is eternal separation from God. Not just going into the grave. It's meaning eternal separation from God. What action, what desire is worth that? Jesus said, he said, what profiteth a man to gain the whole world and lose his what? And what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Amen? People throw all that away to fulfill their desires. And then once it's done, they feel remorseful, but not repentant. You follow me? It's not worth it. And then, this is how the enemy works. I'm going to get off of this in a minute. This is how the enemy works. Once you do it and commit it, he uses it against you. For how long? Forever. Always brings it back. You can be in a service, high anointing. The devil will bring that thought back to your mind, kill your joy. Holding you hostage by your actions and your deeds. Won't he do it?
Amen.
He'll do it. against you. Bring it up. Born into it. All right, let's move on. Thank you, Jesus. Notice what he said. He says, do not err, my beloved brother. Notice, when God is giving you something, it's a good gift. When God is blessing you, it's a good gift. Amen? He says every good gift and perfect gift is from where? Above. So if it isn't good, and if it isn't perfect, it's not from God. Reject it. If it's too good to be true, it's not from God. Reject it. Notice. And coming down from the Father of light, with whom there is no what? Variableness or shadow of turning, meaning that God is not wishy-washy. Read. Of his own will. All right, God begot us with the word of truth according to his will. Read. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be what?
Slow to speak.
Amen. Now, we're going to close it out right now. He said, let everyone be what? Swift to hear. Listen to the Bible study on tonight. Hear it with the intent to obey. Don't speak any harsh words against it. Live according to the word of God. Endure your temptation. Amen? Amen. As promised, I said I was going to let you out early today. I thank God for you. I praise God. And we certainly thank God for this opportunity to have the Bible study on tonight. Amen. Pressing our way into the house of the Lord. And we thank God for our online crew, and it's offering time in the sanctuary, and those of you that desire to give, can give through our tithing. And God will bless you mightily. See you on Sunday, and God bless you in Jesus' name. Have a blessed day.